that money. It has to go somewhere. I'm implying it will go to the state. But you should spell it out and says, but shall be assigned to that state. Likewise, in 1C, when you say such amount shall not form part of the consolidated fund of the state, you should have added, but shall be assigned to what? It can be, it can go nowhere. That's all I'm pointing out. I didn't say it is wrong drafting. I said it is clumsy drafting.
Well, I think since I drew out the history of the clumsy drafting from the Constituent Assembly itself, I think a hair splitting is not a response to this. Now, if you go back to the amendment to Article 269A, subclause 1 clearly says provisions of the Constitution. So the entire exercise, including this Constitution, by order direct that the Constitution during such period as may be specified by that order have effect subject to such adaptations, whether by way of any modification, addition or omission, as he may deem it fit, necessary or expedient. So Article 392.
Let's very quickly bring in reactions from our panel sitting by in our studios very, very patiently in our Mumbai studio. MS Money of Deloitte, Amit Sarkar at Grant Thornton, Sachin Menon, Head of Indirect Tax at KPMG, noted lawyer Rohan Shah and Sandeep Lada, e-commerce leader at PwC. Also with us, our colleague Arun Giri of Tax Suits. So gentlemen, appreciate you joining us. Of course, we will now wait for the vote, and that is the MP from AIADMK. Making his voice heard in the Rajya Sabha once again. They had moved 4 amendments, and the AIADMK has categorically stated right here on CNBC-TV18 that they will consider voting against the GST bill because they believe it's unconstitutional, illegal and immoral unless they are given assurances from the government. And of course, that is Derek O'Brien of the TMC. AIADMK has walked out. That is the breaking news at this point in time. As was expected, the AIADMK with 13 MPs in the Rajya Sabha has walked out. Let's put that news flash out on the screens. Rohan Shah, very quickly, let me get comments from you to start with. You've been watching the discussion and the debate in Parliament. It's been a fascinating almost 7 hours. Your big takeaways as far as the constitutional amendment bill is concerned, as the finance minister pointed out, rates, etc., will be dealt with later. But events of the day, what was the highlight to your mind?
Yeah, one, I think, you know, for the whole country, important to see the sort of quality of constitutional debate we've seen today. Two important takeaways. I think the FM has rightly identified what falls to the GST Council, and you know the rate structure falls there. The dispute resolution mechanism issue also will effectively fall there. But there are two important issues which I don't think have been fully addressed in this debate. The first...
Rohan, may I request you to just hold on for one second because we're listening into Mr. Chidambaram. Let's just see if the Congress makes a point here. Or giving an assurance, so we anticipated some last-minute fireworks and we got those last-minute fireworks. The lobby is being cleared now for the vote. Rohan Shah, you know, Arun was the first one to point out that we could expect some fireworks on this account when the former finance minister this afternoon, when he was speaking in the Rajya Sabha, asked for an assurance that this would not be brought in as a money bill. Very quickly, Rohan, your reactions to what you just saw.
Yeah. I think it's an issue which you know has been making the rounds for the last few days, and it needs to have a resolution, because if it doesn't, to my mind, this is going to resonate in two other issues. One, the 50% vote that you need from the states, and the second, as you rightly said, the meat of the issue is the GST bill. That is something that has to be consented to by all of the states. And if you get into a process where states along political lines choose not to agree or raise issues because they want to be disruptive, then you're really going to have a problem, because if you can't agree consensually to that GST bill, you really won't have a GST. So to my mind, you know, this is probably a little bit of gamesmanship in terms of the parliamentary process. I guess everybody understands that what goes from here the state vote, as also the ultimate consensus on GST bill, requires everybody to agree. So I don't think you can afford to have these dissensions going forward. And I do believe they'll work themselves out, apart from, you know, what we just saw, which I would think was a little bit of just the parliamentary process at its best.
Absolutely, it was parliamentary process at its best. We do need a climax at the end of 7 hours. Sachin Menon, head of indirect tax at KPMG, Rohan Shah giving us his highlight of the day today. Very quickly, the top highlight for you on the 7 hours that we witnessed live here on TV.
Sachin.
I think there is a gap in understanding of the empowered committee as such and the political party representing in the empowered committee, because the intention is to levy a higher rate of tax as opposed to the 18% what is proposed. If that is the intention of the empowered committee, then the empowered committee consisting of many of those opposition parties, their intention to bring that under scrutiny and a discussion in the parliament, in Rajya Sabha, is going against the intention of pushing a reform at the way they want and at the rate what they like without a discussion. Yeah. So here there is a conflict of interest between the political leadership in the Rajya Sabha as well as the members of the board committee in the board committee itself. So therefore, I see a kind of a gap in the understanding between those representing the empowered committee of finance ministers and those who are representing the same political parties in Rajya Sabha.
I think we have the vote, Shiri.
So therefore,
yes, we do have the vote. Let's just very quickly, the vote is currently underway in the Rajya Sabha. Let's just cut to that on a full frame. So let's bring in reactions now. Our expert sitting by with us. Let me go across to Rahul Ghosh of Moody's. He joins us now. Rahul, it seems like in a couple of minutes from now, we would have made our tryst with the historic GST reform. Of course, this is only the first step, the facilitating move towards an eventual GST rollout, perhaps in April 2017. What does this mean for the India economic story?
Yeah, thank you very much. You're right, it is a historic step. This bill has been 10 years in the making, not just this administration, but previous administrations. So it is a historic step, and it is, to many extent, the GST has been seen as a flagship reform for market participants and investors in terms of the willingness and ability of the Modi administration to pass through key economic legislation. You're right, there's still a long way to go in terms of, you know, 50% of states will need to take a look at the amendment, and then we'll have to go with the actual law into the lower house as well. But we do think this does pave the way for eventual implementation and rollout of the GST, which we think is credit positive for both the government and for corporates over the medium term in India.
So you said this is going to be credit positive. So what does this then mean in terms of inflows into India? We've had some strong FDI inflows coming in. What will this now mean in terms of short-term foreign direct flows into the country and also in terms of investor confidence? Because perhaps there was beginning to be a sense of this government not doing enough big bang reforms. Will this now validate the government's reformist credentials?
Yeah, our view towards reform in India has been that it will take place, but it will happen at a very gradual and piecemeal fashion and will require significant political consensus. And this has really been the story of the GST. It's taken a lot of political leadership. It's taken a lot of negotiation behind the scene to get to this point. So in that respect, I do think it's likely to be positive for, you know, short-term inflows into India. But when I talk about the GST implementation being credit positive, we're really taking a medium-term perspective. Clearly, this isn't going to happen overnight. There are legislative hurdles, as I mentioned. There's also some technical ones with IT infrastructure needed to be put in place. But the credit positive nature is really over the coming years and what kind of impact this will have on the business environment in India, which we think will be positive.
Okay, let me go across now to our tax panel. So, gentlemen, it is finally a done deal. Rohan Shah, let me start by asking you, history being created today for India?
Shireen has just asked you whether history has been created, Rohan Bhai.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. I think it's probably the one of the most significant historical moments in our economic history. I think as a nation, we rightly should congratulate ourselves. This is the dawn of a new era and hopefully a wonderful new era in the context of taxation in India.
It is a historic moment. Amit Sarkar, partner at Deloitte at Grant Thornton, also with us. Amit, a quick reaction from you. Of course, a lot of the work in progress will now need to be dealt with on rates and so on and so forth. But just today, after 10 long years, we've finally seen the Constitutional Amendment Bill now being cleared by both houses of Parliament. What does this mean for India?
Well, it's clearly a game-changer moment. As you rightly pointed out, it's been 10 years in the taking. Lots of movements, lots of amendments, lots of adjustments, lots of compromises. I think the takeaway is the decks are now cleared and we now need to see how the fine print comes in. But all of us sitting in the panel can carry away some degree of relief that a 10-year-long wait is now over and we're reaching the last laps, the last 100 meters of the marathon of bringing GST to India.
Well, we hope it's going to be the last 100 meters. Dinesh Kanabar, do you believe that we are going to move forward with much more momentum now? Or as was very evident, there is no consensus as far as rates are concerned. The political sort of middle path that or the balancing act that has got to be walked by both the center and the states is going to be a complicated process. Do you believe that it's going to be a 100 meter dash or is it going to continue to be a marathon?
You know, in the last 10 years that we have been talking about, I have met up with a number of clients, and the moment you start talking about GST, people carry out an evaluation of what they need to do in terms of replanning, logistics, etc., etc., and then a general sense of disbelief that this is never going to happen. Today, we are sending out a signal that this is going to happen. I do think that while I saw this huge debate on whether this should be a money bill or a finance bill, but what I do see is that having gone ahead with the Constitution Amendment Bill, it's now a matter of implementation of process. I'm sure the consensus which has led us to the momentous decision today will continue to drive it forward. There are certain issues which are open. Certainly the drafting of the bill, draft bill leaves a lot to be desired. There'll have to be a lot of work going on that, but those are processes. I think this process now is, so to say, in my mind, irreversible and something which is very, very welcome.
Oh, absolutely. The process has now been set in motion. It is irreversible. And now it boils down to the bill that will be put forward in the winter session of Parliament. Let me also bring in our other guests for quick reactions. Now, Sandeep Ladda, e-commerce leader at PwC, joins us. And also Mr. Jaising joins us from our Bangalore studio. Sandeep, first up, a quick reaction from you. In terms of the sectoral impact, what is this now going to mean, especially for the services sector?
Well, I do think that this is a momentous, historic moment for the country and for the services sector. I think that this will be borderless trade happening across states, which, in many ways, because of the entry tax issue and as currently is being litigated currently in the Supreme Court before a 9-judge bench court, those will probably be the past. And we are looking at borderless trade in a digital economy where borders really don't matter. I think this is a very, very proud moment for the country. Also, I do see that there is enough and more growth happening in the sector. This will certainly provide a more fillip to this particular sector, which has been marred, so to say, with controversies on taxation, especially in the indirect tax space.
Okay, Manish Chokhani joins us now live on the phone line from San Francisco. Manish, it's a done deal now. The Rajya Sabha has given the go-ahead. What does this mean for India? What does it mean for Indian equities? What does it mean in terms of FII inflows?
Well, Shereen, it's really, as I heard the former speaker just speaking, it is really a momentous occasion for us. And I would liken it a bit to the abolition of the License Raj in 1991. This, in a sense, abolishes the Inspector Raj because now you don't go through 17, 18 different officers. And when you change, tariffs and standardize them, it's a bit like going on the, highway with the electronic toll road. And you don't have to sit and keep getting inspected 20 times. So it will increase the flow of business for sure in India. It will change the terms of trade in favor of the organized sector versus the unorganized sector. Evasion goes down. And it's just the velocity of trade and GDP actually will just step up. I would expect to see now a lot of renewed interest also on FDI, while you mentioned the stock markets and FII. I think for a lot of companies looking to invest in a negative interest rate world environment, this is an added fillip to come in, and it's kind of an ease of doing business in India, where you don't have to deal with, you know, 22, 25 different states and different laws and 18 different kinds of taxation. So it is really a big deal. Of course, the timing, you know, is still, I guess, about a year away before it really, you know, comes into effect. And the fine print will come out. But I think it's momentous. When we look back a couple of years, we'll realize that this was really a turning point in India.
Well, it is certainly a turning point. Let me also bring in Arvind Sanger. He joins us now from New York. Arvind, appreciate you joining us. What is this now going to mean from a stock market perspective? Do you believe that, we've already priced this event in, because the rollout will probably still take another year or so, if not longer? What will this now mean as far as Indian equities are concerned?
Well, I mean, I think you'll get a short-term bounce, but I am of the view that, this is a, in the short term, a sell on the news event. But I completely agree with your previous speaker that from a medium to long term standpoint, this is going to have significant long term benefits to India's growth trajectory. If I look out 2, 3, 4 years, because businesses can operate much more efficiently within India without having this archaic system of tariffs between states. So I think from a long term growth trajectory, It is excellent news. From a short-term investment standpoint, next 12, and I would even argue even if the next 24 months, is it going to make a meaningful difference to the earnings growth trajectory? No, but yes, where it might help is it might give businesses a little more confidence in investing, because it now gives a clearer roadmap of investment decisions having to be based on economic rationale of where it's most efficient, rather than having to spend extra money to deal with the tariff situation, therefore making distortions in investment decisions. So I think in that sense, it could even help the economy in the short to medium term, or not short, but medium term, in terms of investment decisions being made by businesses which are waiting for this to pass before making investment decisions.
Oh, that is what we are now waiting for. Let me go across to Sajid Chinoy of JP Morgan. So, Sajid, clause by clause vote is on. So, technically, it isn't a done deal just yet, because the clause by clause vote is still on. But, Sajid, what is this now going to mean, especially in the first year or 2 years, as far as the rollout is concerned? If one were to assume a rate of 18% or a rate between 18 and 22%, the finance minister making it clear that the state finance minister's panel are uncomfortable with the Subramaniam committee's recommendations on rates, and perhaps it could be higher than that. What will it mean in terms of inflation, for instance, as we roll out the GST?
Yeah. I think it's important first to step back and look at the bigger picture. You know, all reforms could have near-term dislocational impacts, but I think the larger picture is this is, game-changing, transformative. This is India's version of signing a free trade agreement with itself. So really, in the medium term, this is quite historic. I think that the tax rate will matter enormously, because I think one of the whole benefits and attractions of the GST is the self-policing nature that should crowd in compliance. Now, what you don't want to do is peg the rate so high and take such a static view of things that you forget about the dynamism that this may cause in growth in the future, and in fact discourage compliance in the near term. I'll just make a couple of quick points. It's not unprecedented that in the first year or two, there could be a growth inhibiting feature to this, because remember, service tax rates will go up, goods tax rates will come down. Now, there's always an asymmetry where firms will be very quick to pass on the service tax rates, which are 60% of GDP, whereas the goods firms which experience rate reductions may retain some of those for themselves. So you could find this asymmetry that the consumer faces. It's possible, therefore, that demand for services and services growth may slow temporarily. It's also possible that core CPI may go up because of the services component. But I want to emphasize, these are all short-term, transitional, dislocations. In a few years, we'll figure out that if done correctly, this will lead to huge allocative efficiency, much lower logistics costs, and therefore costs in general should come down, and prices over time should come down. So let's brace ourselves for the fact that you could be near-term dislocations, but in the medium term, this is unambiguously positive.
It is unambiguously positive. Let me also bring in an industry perspective. Naushad Forbes, the president of the Confederation of Indian Industry, also joins us now. Mr. Forbes, thanks very much for joining us. It's a big day for India. It's a big day for the Indian economy. It will perhaps enhance competitiveness of India Inc. as well. Well, we'll get to him in just a second, but let me go back across to some of our other experts. Manish, very quickly, in terms of short-term sort of impact, sectoral impact particularly, do you believe that this is largely been priced in, or we will perhaps see an upside from these levels, or do you believe valuations are already high?
No, Shireen, I think Arvind said it right, that the market was expecting this to come through. So valuations, for example, in cement, automobiles, where you expect that this will be beneficial, are priced in. Having said that, this really changes the P multiple for India, and therefore the terminal value in a sense of the country goes up, because it looks like a much easier place to do business, things are more standardized and so on. So while there may be, in fact, a reverse effect where people sell on the news and they had bought earlier on the rumor. As things go ahead and actually the developments unfold, I think markets will only trend upwards after that.
Yeah, come on. Well, that is right. Let's also bring in some of our other guests who join us. We've been speaking with a whole bunch of them, Nandan Nilekani, Arvind Panagaria, and of course, Adi Godrej. A lot of big voices joining us here right on CNBC-TV18. Arvind Panagaria, the Vice Chairman of the Niti Aayog. We also have with us Thomas Isaac, the Finance Minister of Kerala as well. Let me go across now to the Infosys co-founder, Nandan Nilekani. Mr. Nilekani, thanks very much for joining us. Let me start by asking you, do you believe the GST has the potential to revolutionize the tax landscape? You've, of course, yourself been involved with, in a sense, designing the GST architecture for at least the IT backbone.
Oh, absolutely. I think the GST will make India a single market for goods and services, reduce transaction cost, and enable business to grow. I think a critical part of that will be the proper implementation of the GST network, a technology company which is building the platform and making everything paperless. So that's a very important part of achieving this goal.
Let me go across. Nandan, I'm going to come back to you on the IT infrastructure in just a second, but let me also bring in Adi Godrej. Mr. Godrej, the rate has yet to be decided. The lower rate, of course, will be a big benefit as far as industry is concerned. 15% to 18% is what has been bandied about by the CA panel. Unlikely to be as low as that is what we're picking up at this point in time. Your first reaction, sir.
Once the GST is rolled out, it will be tremendous for the Indian economy and for Indian industry. I expect that the GDP growth of the country will go up by 1.5 to 2 percentage points, other things being equal, once this is brought into play by 1st of April 2017. Industry will benefit tremendously because tax rates will be lower. Competition from tax evaders in the medium and small scale will be done away with. Logistics costs will come down tremendously. Exports will benefit because all taxes will get refunded, unlike in the present regime. And overall, there'll be tremendous benefits. Consumption will go up, production will go up, investments will go up. So I see India getting into a double-digit GDP growth rate now that the monsoon is also panning out well and expected to pan out well for 3 or 4 monsoons. I think India will be in an extremely good position.
Well, you expect a significant pickup as far as the economy is concerned. Let me also go across now to the chairman of the country's largest car maker, R.C. Bhargav. Welcome to the show, sir. History has been created today. Do you really believe that this piece of legislation will deliver on the promise of revolutionizing business in India, enhancing competitiveness in India? What will the GST truly mean, sir?
Well, certainly it's something we have all been waiting for a long, long time. And of course, as you have been saying, it's an enabling piece of legislation, but it was a roadblock which prevented anything happening further. So once this gets passed hopefully today, then I think we can go ahead and hope that all the other steps will be taken. But along with that, I think the focus also needs now to be kept more on the implementational machinery for GST, because legislation on paper will be no good without a very effective system for enforcing the GST system.
You're right on that front. Execution and implementation is now going to be the key. Pavan Goenka up next of Mahindra and Mahindra. Mr. Goenka, thanks very much for joining us. Let me ask you about the implication. Similar question that I put to Mr. Bhargav. A lot of contentious issues, at least if you look at the draft of the model law, and the fine print still needs to be worked out. There hasn't been enough stakeholder feedback is what we're given to understand from the government. What is it that industry would like clarification or clarity on going forward when it comes to things like the model law?
Well, let me just sort of put it in two, three buckets. The first bucket is a transition, how we transit from the current indirect tax regime to GST. And for many industries, specifically auto industry, the transition is going to be fairly complex because of our very long lead time from when something gets started in manufacturing to when it gets sold to the end consumer, and a lot of things in between. So we have to plan out the transition very carefully so that the industry does not end up in a sort of confusion during the period from, let's say, January, February to May or June. So that's a very important issue for us. The second issue is complexity of documentation. And right now, as we look at the model GST law that has been put down, there's still a lot of things that we need to fine-tune, that we need to work on. We shouldn't end up in a situation where GST by itself becomes a very complex requirement of compliance, documentation, and so on. So the government has to look at very carefully and talk to industry, understand from the stakeholders what all we are concerned about in terms of documentation.
Oh, you're right on that front. But Mr. Goenka, let me go back to Nandan Nilekani. Nandan, you were at the forefront of creating the IT infrastructure for the GST. What were the challenges that you faced? And do you expect that things are in order or will be in order for the rollout if it does happen on the 1st of April 2017?
Well, I think creating the technology infrastructure for GST well ahead of time was thanks to the foresight of Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, who was the finance minister at that time, and he set up a committee under me to create this body, and it's a unique body which is owned by the central government and the state government and by some financial institutions, and excellent leadership. Mr. Chairman Naveen Kumar and the Prakash Kumar is the MD. So they've done a lot of work and they've implemented a lot of things, and I'm very confident that they will be ready in time for the launch date, whenever it is.
Whenever it is, at this point in time, we are expecting the government to continue with the April 1, 2017 timeline, though there has been no commitment. But Nandan, tax experts point out that the IT industry will perhaps be faced with some disruptive or transitory pain points. Can you take us through what the likely impact may be, especially as far as the IT sector is concerned?
Well, I don't know the detail, but obviously the law should be drafted in a way that it simplifies ease of doing business, and the law should be drafted keeping in mind that we will have a very advanced technology and a lot of the business rules can be implemented through technology. I think that's what needs to be done.
All right, Nandan, let me go across and for the benefit of our viewers, play out a conversation that I had with the Vice Chairman of the Niti Aayog, Arvind Panagaria. He believes that the GST will weed out inefficiencies from the system, and that's the argument that's also being put forward by the government and by the Finance Minister in Parliament. He also believes that there will be a significant bump up on account of the GST rollout and GST implementation.
In terms of the efficiency effects, I think, you know, once we have a properly functioning GST, a lot of the current inefficiencies and what economists call the distortions in the system will be eliminated. So I really think also it will speed up a lot of the processes because simplification that is required, that was required for indirect taxes, will also have happened as a result of this. So I think this ought to give us a good efficiency gain, and therefore also some impact both on the level of GDP as well as the rate at which it grows.
What to your mind would be an appropriate rate, given also the experience that we've seen everywhere else in the world where the GST rate is significantly lower than the one that we are embarking on?
We really haven't done any independent calculation, but I am confident that at the end of the day, we would reach a reasonable compromise. And in any case, you know, some of it may have to be fine-tuned as we go forward. And this is the reason, actually, that the constitutional provision itself ensures that any states that lose revenue will be compensated fully for up to 5 years.
Mr. Godrej, let me come back to you, because the rate still has to be decided for the industry, sir. But, you know, apart from the rate impact, how big are things like warehousing, logistics-related costs? You know, we believe that transaction costs, especially logistics costs, are expected to come down quite significantly with the rollout of the GST.
Logistics will make a big impact, but that's not the biggest impact. The biggest impact will be the rate. The rate will be lower than the current rates. And the next biggest impact will be the elimination of unfair competition from tax evaders. Tax evasion becomes almost impossible under GST.
You believe that evasion will come down, compliance will improve. Let me bring in Rana Kapoor of Yes Bank, also joins us now on the phone line. Mr. Kapoor, it's a big day for India. The most ambitious and most awaited tax reform now getting the go-ahead, at least the first step towards the rollout of the GST. What does this mean for the economy, sir?
So, Shireen, as many of your very prestigious speakers have said, that this is a game changer. In my judgment, this is probably the most exponential reform that we have seen in our country, far beyond some of the other incremental measures that have been taken over the last, you know, few months. And I think this is a stratospheric change in India's economy. I think Adi made that point a little while ago. I also believe that we are probably, you know, stepping into a double-digit growth environment. The tailwinds of the monsoons, you know, far better macroeconomic conditions. And then this reform becomes like the icing on the cake. And I have every reason to believe that this will further augment India's stature as an investment destination. It will rebuild the confidence and conviction by the private sector, which has come to a grinding halt as far as, you know, fresh investments are concerned. And I think this will augur very, very well and for a second takeoff of our economy, which is poised exceedingly well at this moment.
Mr. Kapoor, specifically from a financial services industry point of view, what will the implications be of the GST rollout, sir?
Well, in the short term, you know, naturally there will be a bump up in the overall service tax implications. It may go up from effectively 15% to possibly 18%. So there could be short term, you know, implications, but in a sense that, you know, if the economy picks up, naturally credit demand picks up, and there will be unleashing a fair number of multipliers in industries that have been languishing. So I think many industries that have been somewhat crippled or have gone through some kind of choking as an infrastructure, particularly transportation, logistics, I think the agri-infrastructure sector will get, you know, further benefits. So I think the overall credit demand will get, you know, catalyzed steadily by this by this orbit-changing intervention.
Mr. Kapoor, hang in there. Let me also bring in the chief of the Vedanta Group, chairman of Vedanta Resources, Anil Agarwal, joins us on the phone line from London. Mr. Agarwal, thank you very much for joining us. It's a big day with the Constitutional Amendment Bill being passed by the Rajya Sabha. Of course, the GST Bill, which will deal with the more complicated issues, will be taken up in the winter session. But what does this mean, sir, for the India story? And how will foreign investors now look at this?
This is a historical moment. I think after a couple of decades, something like this has happened, which will have a phenomenal reaction overseas market. This will do definitely ease of doing business. It will bring in more revenue to the government. It will bring the whole lot of transparency. This we've been looking for a long time, this thing to happen. I'm really congratulate the entire government what they have done this. My only thing is implementation of this to be done very quickly as possible, should not get down to unnecessarily, nitty-gritty.
Let me ask you specifically from the oil and gas sector's perspective, Mr. Agarwal, because petroleum products are zero rated. The finance minister saying that once the GST Council's approval comes in, they hope that petroleum products will come under the ambit of the GST. So broadly for the oil and gas sector, what will the rollout of the GST mean?
Yeah, it's for every sector. I'm not in the refining business. I'm in the upstreaming. We produce crude oil of the country. We produce 30% oil of the country. And but I'm saying bringing it. It has happened all over the world. All the developed country has this. And what is bringing a biggest thing will happen, but there will be unaccounted money. Will be, I won't say it'll come off, but it'll be come down very drastically. It will improve the economy. I would say because of GST bill, at least 1% of GDP will improve.
Okay, you believe that 1% of GDP will improve on account of the GST rollout. But Mr. Agarwal, foreign investors have been talking about the need for big bang reforms in India. There was perhaps a sense that the government was going through an incremental reform process. What will this mean? Will this vindicate the government's position and its reformist credentials?
Absolutely. This is they always believe that this is the majority government, which has come after a long time, and they should do the this strong reformation. And this GST bill pass is one of the strongest which has happened. I'm saying to implement this, the government has to be very, very focused to make sure that this get implemented.
Mr. Agarwal, I don't know if you've had a look at the fine print or your team has given you any or raised any apprehensions with the GST rollout, but if there are any clarifications that you would like to seek, perhaps the government is watching, sir, what would you like to see from here on as far as the actual implementation and execution of the GST is concerned?
Yeah, but what I'm far distance, but I understand that it has to go to all the states. Then it has to come back to the parliament, and then it has to come back to the Rajya Sabha. So these things has to be time-bound program. This has to be time-bound program, so it can really give relief for ease of doing business.
Okay, hang in there, Mr. Agarwal. I'll come back to you. Rana Kapoor, very quickly now, as we move towards the execution implementation stage, as we move towards the actual GST bill itself, which should be taken up in the winter session of Parliament, what are the areas of concern? What are the pain points that you would like addressed?
I think, Shireen, at this moment of time, we have to see, and apply the 80-20 rule. In my judgment, the bill has addressed more than 80 to 90% of the contentious issues. And, naturally, when it comes to process management, to its successful implementation, naturally, there will be some hiccups, there will be some speed breakers, so there will be implementation issues. I'm very happy that, in my reading today, I found that there is a GSTN, the GST network. Mm-hmm. So there is a fair amount of digital preparation for this particular, you know, act to convert to reality, because naturally the next steps have got to do a lot with, you know, the overall digitization of the processes. And to me, getting the implementation going, despite some limitations, you know, 10-20% gaps that may be there, with some states naturally going through a process of literacy and its implementation. So I think the first and foremost thing is to really roll out, you know, the electronic omni channels that will be required, the digital channels that will be required, and get the
I'm going to interrupt you for just a second, sir. I'm going to interrupt you for just a second, because now the bill has been passed by the Rajya Sabha. As we were caveating, the clause-by-clause vote was on. Now all clauses have been voted on. Some amendments have, of course, also been withdrawn. And now the bill stands passed by the Rajya Sabha. So it is now a done deal. Clause-by-clause voting is over. The Rajya Sabha has cleared the GST bill. Let me go across to our panel of tax experts who are sitting by with us in Mumbai. And Sachin Menon, let me start by asking you about the one or two areas of priority that you now believe the government now needs to start work on, and then I'll pass it around to the panel sitting next to you.
Well, since we have passed this, biggest hurdle of passing this in the Rajya Sabha is got done now. Now the devil is in the detail. That is, the GST draft law which has been circulated is not a real GST draft law. It is a culmination or cut and paste of the service tax, the current VAT law, the excise law. All these provisions have been copied and put together, and we call it as a GST law. Now, all of us, including the Empowered Committee and the lawmakers, need to think seriously how to get that respect for this letter of law, which is called GST law, and how you are going to address these issues, which is a long-standing, which is still continued or still being framed in the draft current GST law. And the playground is now moving from there to looking at seriously what is the law which is best for India, and what is that you have stated in the policy document, and what is that you have churned out as a GST bill. So this
All
is
right,
what is the next most important.
That's the next step.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the next step and the most important step. Let me go across to Dharmesh Mehta, also with us. Dharmesh, we were just talking to Manish Chokhani, Arvind Sanger. Both believe that, this is long-term positive for India. Moody's, Rahul Ghosh with us, also saying that this is credit positive for India. What should we expect now as far as the markets are concerned, Dharmesh?
Well, look, markets were expecting this bill to go through, so I don't believe it will be a euphoric stage. But clearly, this is a long-term P upgrade for India, which was in the waiting for a long time. It's a historic day. So markets should be very happy with what has happened. The reforms are back. This was the big, big bank reform, which everybody was expecting and wanted. That's finally over. The monkey's off the back. And now clearly, the markets will now look forward. How do we implement this? Clearly, it's not going to happen tomorrow morning. So it's going to take 1 or 2 years for the real implementation. But clearly, now the corporates will start doing business planning instead of tax planning. That will save a lot of money and efficiency for their own capital. So markets should be very happy with this event today.
Arvind, from a sectoral perspective, there are concerns on what this will mean for the telecom sector, what in general this is actually going to mean as far as the services sector is concerned. From a sectoral perspective, would you change your position given the possibility of the rollout of the GST now from an equity perspective?
Well, I mean, I guess there are going to be winners and losers. Some of the service sectors and maybe telecom and others might have high taxes, others may have low taxes. So we're going to have to study that closer. We're not going to be, you know, jumping and making big moves just because of the GST passage in terms of specific investment. I think most of our current investments are either neutral or positively impacted by GST, but there probably will be some negative fallout. It's not, let's be clear, it's not, you know, good for everybody. There'll be some losers. But clearly the biggest loser, if you look at it in a broader sense, is the informal sector, which doesn't pay taxes. Those are not companies that we invest in. And the biggest winner in general is the formal sector that does generally pay taxes. So therefore, in that sense, I think it's good for public companies, for the markets, the way we measure it. And therefore, we think that that'll be a positive. But specific companies or sectors that are losers or winners, I think we'll have to study the fine-tune the details to understand better if there's anybody that is significantly negatively impacted. I think the service sector is the one that we think of as having some negative outcome, yeah. But I suspect it's not huge.
Let me go across to Mr. Jaising from Bangalore. Mr. Jaising, you wanted to comment on the point that's being made, and this is something that a lot of we've lost that line with him. We'll come back to him in just a second. But that is a concern that is being raised now as far as the implications for the services sector. Rohan, you know, let me come back to you now. What is it that you would like to see being addressed? Because there are several issues that the model law throws up that require urgent clarification.
That's right, Shireen. There is a lot of work to be done. But may I just make one point to add to what all the other panelists have said, which is that the most important thing this is going to do is to restore the tax credibility of India as a nation. You have a lot of domestic and international companies who wonder that when they pay a sales tax in the origin state, you know, they have to pay something, there is a demand in the destination state. And they're paying tax twice or thrice over. You have a license in terms of IPR, and you will end up paying tax on it as a service and also as goods. What the GST does is completely take away all of this dissonance and puts us into a credible, predictable global tax system. So I think that's the really big gain. And that's a gain for the Indian industry and everyone who will potentially already, you know, look at investing in us or has already invested in us. Coming to the changes, I think, yes, there is a lot to be done.
Can I request you to hold on the changes for just a second, Rohan? I'll come back to you. But Naushad Forbes, the president of CII, also joins us. Mr. Forbes, you know, you and Fiki have been running this campaign to get all political parties on board to ensure the passage of the GST bill. It's happened. It's a done deal now. Good times?
Absolutely. We're delighted. It has finally happened. And I think our compliments to both the government for persisting in seeing the GST bill safely through, and indeed to the main opposition party as well, to the Congress for working in the last few weeks very constructively to improve the bill that we finally got.
Mr. Forbes, there clearly is no consensus on the rate so far. When we spoke with you earlier, you had said that anything higher than 20% was going to be unpalatable for industry. But it's clear that the state finance ministers don't buy the Arvind Subramaniam recommendations. Is that now worrying you?
Well, you know, I think there's the government guarantee to essentially make up any shortfalls in revenue for states for 5 years. Provides ample room to actually try a rate out that is in line with the Arvind Subramaniam report and then see how it goes. You know, we're quite confident that two things will happen. First, you know, there are many items, especially services, where taxes are going to rise and where many services are going to be brought into the tax net. And all of that will provide a lot of buoyancy in tax revenue. So, I think the Arvind Subramaniam report is quite a thorough report and one which we should have some confidence in. So we have greater confidence in the 18% sticking once it is actually implemented. I do think that at a rate that is, you know, anything over 20% will probably end up being not only inflationary, but I think it will actually depress demand for several.
Okay, let me very quickly get a final comment in from Rahul Ghosh of Moody's before he signs off. Rahul, you know, a big day, but what more would you like to see now as far as your sort of commitment to the India reform story is concerned?
Yes, so we have a positive outlook on India's Baa3 sovereign rating. And clearly what we've seen today is credit positive, as I mentioned earlier. I think someone mentioned a very important point, which is on tax credibility and tax efficiency. And, you know, as we know, in the World Bank's Doing Business survey, India stands at 157th for paying taxes. That's in line with countries such as Gabon, countries such as Nigeria. So this is going to be a more simplified tax system will be positive. I think from a sovereign credit perspective as well, the compliance issue is a significant one. Government revenues to GDP are around 23% in India, much lower than other rated peers at around 30%. 5%. So if we can increase the government revenues via a more simplified GST, that will help India's fiscal position, and that will ultimately support India's sovereign rating.
Well, that is good news. All of this should ensure that we actually get that ratings upgrade as well. But Rahul, appreciate you joining us here on CNBC-TV18. Apologies to Rohan Shah. I interrupted you while you were taking us through the clarifications that are required from the model law and the changes that will be needed. Rohan, go ahead.
Yeah. Shireen, two important things which I think we still need to constitutionally look out for. One, the GST Council is only recommendatory. And if it had any role beyond that, you know, it would impinge on the whole federal structure. So given that it's recommendatory, ultimately it is going to require everybody to form consensus. And that's one issue to keep your eye on. The second is, under the Constitution, Article 131 secures to the Supreme Court the exclusive right to look at interstate disputes or center versus state disputes. How will the dispute resolution mechanism that is now suggested by the council be compatible with this is another issue that we need to look out for. So I don't think all the constitutional issues are sort of still dead and buried. And coming to the detailing, you know, there will be issues arising from the very concept of supply, which is what is taxable, to the place of supply, to the time of supply, to the whole factor of, you know, where and when you will pay the tax, the robustness of the whole credit system, and the robustness of the factor that if you do have a dispute, how quickly are you able to resolve it and how final is that solution going to be? So all of these, we have suggestions in the context of the draft law. But I think the draft law is a basic document which will need a lot of work. And it also will need consensus. And if that is so, then is 3 months actually enough? Because we are now talking of a November, December sort of re-engagement in Parliament. And from that perspective, I don't think this time might be sufficient. People will really have to work over time. And the one thing I think we ought not to do in the exuberance that we have is to bring a law that is difficult for industry to live with, or a law that will, in a way, foster more litigation going forwards.
Yeah.
So I think we need to invest everything that we can into these next 3 months to address the open issues, which are quite well identified.
Absolutely. But let me go across to Sajid Chinoy of JP Morgan. Sajid, you know, it is all going to come down to now the rates. And as we heard in that parliamentary debate today, you know, there are questions being raised about the recommendations of the CAA's panel. The finance minister also very clearly suggesting that perhaps we will need to move higher beyond that 17 to 19% band that was recommended, because the CAA panel didn't factor in the cesses and it didn't factor in, I forget, one other issue. But where do you stand as far as rates are concerned? We've got the NIPFP's recommendations, the CA panel's recommendations, and now the state FM panel suggesting that they would like a rate between 20 to 22%.
So I come out with the Arvind Subramaniam committee. I think that's a very thorough committee. It's gone through the numbers in great detail. And I think, you know, there are two parts here that we need to keep in mind. One is that these things are dynamic. The higher the rate that you may place on paper, the more you will discourage compliance. So we have to keep that in mind, that, you know, there's a Laffer curve in taxation where, you know, at a taxation rate of 100%, your revenues are zero, essentially, right? So I think that the committee is mindful of that. And the second thing is, there is a dynamism to activity itself that we cannot forget. The experience from GSTs in other countries has been that at a relatively low, you know, what was deemed to be a revenue neutral rate in the first year, actually, you know, resulted in revenue buoyancy and tax buoyancy much more than had been anticipated, because you had better compliance, you had a larger tax base, and you had more allocative efficiency. So I think, you know, what Naushad mentioned makes eminent sense, that because there is this backstop where states will be compensated by the center for up to 5 years, it makes eminent sense to start with a rate that's deemed to be reasonable, both from a revenue perspective and from an industry perspective, and then see whether chips fall, you always have the option to increase that rate going forward. You know, but there's an asymmetry. If you start with a very high rate, it always becomes harder to reduce the rate going forward. So, you know, I'll end by saying I think the Arvind Subramaniam Committee recommendations on the structure of rates seem very feasible, and I think is in the order of magnitude of, you know, where we should start this process by. What we don't want to do is start at a very high number on paper, which essentially undermines the very essence of the GST, which is higher compliance through a self-policing framework.
Dharmesh, let me get in a final comment from you before I let you go. So what are you going to be watching out for starting tomorrow, Dharmesh?
Well, one thing is that the event is over, so people are happy, and that is done deal. Obviously, now we have to see how the implementation happened. As the panelists said, there are a lot of things yet to be sorted out. But the good news is that the bill has passed, so eventually we'll get to there, you know, where everybody agrees on certain parameters and we start implementing these projects. And the fact of the life is that this government has been very instrumental in going and executing a lot of this kind of reforms. So I'm sure with this kind of help with technology, the digitalization, they'll be able to implement this much faster. So markets definitely going to be happy with this. But don't forget that markets was expecting this event, so there was some build-up in the markets expecting the GST bill will go through. But in the long term,
that is the consensus, it's a PE upgrade. Yeah, long-term positive, yeah. A PE upgrade warranted?
Definitely warranted, and there will be a lot of cost saving. So there will be no unnecessary expenditure on, you know, setting up projects or setting up plants in a tax havens and all those kind of stuff. That will go away. So clearly a PE upgrade and some kind of cost saving coming in. But net-net, this was the biggest reform which everybody was looking for, especially the foreigners, and that's behind us now.
All right. Let me go across to Mahesh Jaising, partner at BMR Associates as well. Mahesh, appreciate you joining us. We were talking about the sectoral impact and largely what this is now going to mean as far as the services sector is concerned. Your first thought?
Yeah, I think, Shireen, the talk of 15 to 18% is one part, but I think the one that's far more complicated and concerning companies, particularly services companies in the technology space, is taxation of services. So let's not forget that what we're talking about is a new GST regime, which is at a state-level basis of taxation is what is on the cards. So I think there's a lot of ground to be covered in terms of understanding how would pan-India contracts be taxed. So if there are an IT company headquartered in Bangalore with their clients across the country and servicing is being done right from their offices across the country, where would the tax trigger come from and where would they need to pay the tax? Would they need to slice and dice their contracts? Would they need to be splitting invoices? This is an area that's really concerning. And you know, like Rohan said earlier, that the last thing that we want is that in this momentum game that the law is rolled out in a manner that there's going to be immense litigation later. So a little bit of pessimism on my side on the as far as services tax is concerned, that these companies and the government
should work. It's a reality check, Mahesh. Don't call it pessimism. It's a reality check. While we're all celebrating history, it's also good to know what we're going to have to face a couple of weeks, months down the road. So it's good to have that reality check as well.
It certainly is, and I think we've just got 3 months to engage with the government.
Let's listen into the finance minister. He's speaking with our colleague Sapna Das.
In India itself, the fact that it has been passed and passed unanimously, all regional parties and national parties have actively supported it. The proceedings have culminated to demonstrate to the world that this is a great day both for Indian democracy and Indian federalism. In fact, Indian democracy and Indian federalism are at their very best in as much as all national political parties and regional parties, all state governments have come together to usher a major taxation reform. On behalf of the government, I express my deep sense of gratitude to all the political parties which have actively participated in this discussion and supported this reform. The government's approach also was to build a larger consensus, which we succeeded in doing. We now propose to take some of the additions and amendments which have been made to the bill as approved by the Lok Sabha back to the Lok Sabha very soon, subject to the directions of the Speaker. so that the Lok Sabha also can approve the bill and then it can go to the states for ratification. Once the GST is implemented, it will bring basic changes as far as the Indian tax structure is concerned. It will convert India into one unified market with one unified tax in the country. It will improve the base of taxation. It will make evasion extremely difficult. And I think the center and the state governments in future will have to work together in order to make this a great success. Overall, I think it was an excellent debate in which almost every member has contributed to it. And as I just stated earlier, this is Indian democracy and federalism both at their very best. Thank you. आज ये महत्वपूर्ण अवसर है इस देश के लिए कि एक बहुत महत्वपूर्ण टैक्सेशन रिफॉर्म कर व्यवस्था में सुधार संसद ने पारित किया है. महत्व का विषय यह है कि ये सुधार सर्वसम्मति से पास हुआ है. लगभग हर राजनीतिक दल ने इसका समर्थन किया है. राज्य सरकारों के बीच में भी एक आम राय थी और उन्होंने भी इसका समर्थन किया और इसलिए इस देश का लोकतंत्र और इस देश का संघीय ढांचा, उसकी जो ताकत और शक्ति है वो पूरे विश्व के सामने आज स्पष्ट रूप से प्रकट होती है कि देश हित में सभी राजनीतिक दल, सभी राज्य सरकारें एक आवाज में आम राय बन जाए तो एक दिशा में जा सकती हैं. मैं सभी राजनीतिक दलों का और राज्य सरकारों का बहुत आभार व्यक्त करता हूं कि इस महत्वपूर्ण कानून का उन्होंने समर्थन किया है. इसको अब हम लोग लोकसभा में लेकर जाएंगे और स्पीकर साहिबा से डायरेक्शन लेकर जितनी शीघ्र ये आ पाएगा उतनी शीघ्र इसको लागू करने का प्रयास करेंगे. आई थिंक वील मूव सिस्टमैटिकली. देयर इज स्टिल अ लॉन्ग रोड टू बी कवर्ड. इट हैज टू बी अप्रूव्ड बाय द लोकसभा द चेंजेस, देन इट हैज टू बी रेटिफाइड बाय द स्टेट असेंबली, देन द जीएसटी काउंसिल हैज टू बी कॉन्स्टिट्यूटेड. द जीएसटी काउंसिल देन वुड in turn be preparing the drafts, which under the present constitutional amendment will go before the parliament and also the state assemblies in respective cases. They will then settle the rate of taxes. There are some procedural issues which are to be sorted out, and I think what is well begun is substantially done. See, I would like to do it as soon as possible.
The finance minister being ambushed there in parliament, but essentially reiterating the story that they've managed to get consensus. State governments are on board. A historic day for India. They will now move to the Lok Sabha tomorrow. But let's listen in to Kapil Sibal in conversation with our colleagues.
And this government is actually going to meet the concerns of the various state governments and moving forward in bringing a comprehensive legislation to this house in November. I wish the finance minister all the best.
Thank you so much for speaking to CNBC.
Well, the mood has changed. It's a mood of conciliation. That is Kapil Sibal, Rajya Sabha MP of the Congress Party, congratulating the finance minister on getting the GST bill done. It couldn't have happened without the Congress's support. Let's listen in now to Cabinet Minister Prakash Javadekar, the new HRD minister.
It's not about government or party. Under the able leadership of Narendra Modi, the way our finance minister Arun Jaitley worked out to the last detail and continued with the dialogue, that has resulted in this victory. I must credit all parties rose to the occasion and have supported, because it is the people wish has triumphed. Because people want to take it to the next level of reforms, and that is what is.
But Javadekar ji, the complaint which was also made against your government was that, you know, it's only in the end you try to take other political parties like the Congress along. Till then, there was no cooperation coming from your government.
This has started from so many years, and we have worked out through dialogue. And ultimately, everything is good that ends good.
Thank you so much for speaking to me.
Well, that is Prakash Javadekar there talking about the GST bill passing through the Rajya Sabha. Let me go back to our tax experts now. You know, just on this business of what we can expect and how soon we can expect this, of course, Rohan, as the finance minister was pointing out, they'll move to the Lok Sabha and have the amendments being ratified by the Lok Sabha, and then the process of setting up the GST Council will take place. What kind of issues do you foresee there? Because in that sense, the GST Council is really, while it's recommendatory in nature, it really is going to hold all the cards, isn't it?
It's going to hold the most important three cards. So one is rate, the second is the model law, and the third is in terms of the dispute resolution. So all of these are going to be critical to the ultimate shape of the GST that we will get. And, you know, once we are done with the Constitution Amendment Bill, I think all of the focus essentially now shifts to the GST bill itself. And what we will get as that model law, which again, needs consensus from the states. And this is likely to be far more difficult because on the constitutional issue, you issued generically to a certain change which would enable the introduction of the GST. But as you get to the model law, you're going to get to the nitty-gritty, which has an impact in arithmetical terms differently for different states. So I wouldn't underestimate...
Rohan, just hang on, Rohan. Mr. Chidambaram, in conversation with our colleagues, let's listen in.
We've improved it considerably. It may not be entirely to our satisfaction, but I think we have brought home to the government that more homework has to be done by them.
Mr. Chidambaram, the biggest concern is regarding as far as the state's interests are concerned. Have you got that kind of an assurance from the finance minister that the state's interests will be kept in mind?
I think the government still does not know what kind of consensus will emerge in the GST Council.
But there's still a long way to go, isn't there?
I think so.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chidambaram.
There is a long way to go. Rohan Shah, continue.
Yeah. So, you know, endorsing that, that there is a lot of detailing. And as you get to this GST bill, as I said, the true nature of arithmetical impact will actually be determined at that stage. And therefore, while right now we've agreed to the generic principle of enabling the GST, and, you know, that itself has taken time, don't underestimate the time that it will take to form the consensus in the second phase, because this has a direct arithmetical impact, and people will want to guard their turf far more zealously. So this is where, really, you know, the whole situation of the federal cooperation that we are talking of and the real man management and party management skills of the BJP top brass will really come into play again, because this next phase of consensus, which is very detail bound, is certainly going to be more challenging.
So is the April 2017 deadline, is it possible or not? I think that's the key. Are we looking at an April 2017 deadline, or are we looking at October 2017?
The issue is, I don't think this is time bound. I think this really needs to be more qualitative. Are we going to deliver to the nation a GST which will truly deliver everything that we wanted to deliver? Do not forget that globally, GST has not always been successful. Malaysia has had its problem. Nigeria has had its problems. Therefore, the quality of delivery, to me, is more important than the timing of the delivery. If you can deliver quality by 1st April, certainly. But if you can't, then, you know, I think you really have to vote in favor of the quality of this legislation and the positive impact it can have.
I think Mr. Money from Deloitte wants to have a quick word before he leaves. Mr. Money?
Yeah, all that I would say over here is, in the process of the run-up to the GST, we have been having a lot of suggestions given by various industrial sectors. Because since GST is one common indirect tax affecting all the sectors, what would typically happen is that the issues which are relevant for manufacturing would be a little different from the issues that are relevant for a bank. Issues that are relevant for a bank would be different from those which are relevant for pharma manufacturing. So in the time that we have got, I believe we have got enough time now to focus on very specific sectoral issues and get a tax, as Rohan mentioned earlier, that is good for all sectors. Because at a broad level, what we have seen in respect of the model bill, it is trying to accommodate everything and do a lot of things for everyone. Now, which is not necessarily a good thing to do. And if you go by the example of Malaysia, where they have tried to attempt having sector-wise provisions in some parts of the GST.
Mani, let's just listen into the finance minister. We'll go back to him in just a second. Sorry, I interrupted you, Mani. Finish your point.
Yeah, so China is again planning to, has planned to introduce their VAT reform on the basis of a sector. And therefore, at some point of time, I think it is necessary for the government now to focus on the various issues that have been provided to them in terms of the challenges facing various sectors and ensure that all of them are incorporated in the final GST bill when it comes out. That is something which will make the wait worthy. I mean, we have been waiting for a very long time. People said 10 years and 1 years and two more years. However long it takes, let's get a GST which addresses most of the issues of the majority of the sectors.
Yeah, Shireen, just look at this. The FM is there, I think.
I'll make a brief statement first in English, then in Hindi.
Thank you.
Well, today is indeed a historic day for the reason that the Rajya Sabha, in which the GST bill had been held up for a very long time, has cleared the bill. I think what is most important is, as the voting itself showed, that the bill has been cleared unanimously. So all members present at the time of voting have voted in favor of the bill. And as the debate progressed, it was clear that amongst political parties, there was a very large consensus. Except one political party, everybody else has supported this bill. Everybody has voted in favor of the bill. And almost every state government is on board in order to implement one of the most important taxation reforms in India itself. The fact that it has been passed and passed unanimously, all regional parties and national parties have actively supported it. The proceedings have culminated to demonstrate to the world that this is a great day both for Indian democracy and Indian federalism. In fact, Indian democracy and Indian federalism are at their very best, in as much as all national political parties and regional parties, all state governments have come together to usher a major taxation reform. On behalf of the government, I express my deep sense of gratitude to all the political parties which have actively participated in this discussion and supported this reform. The government's approach also was to build a larger consensus, which we succeeded in doing. We now propose to take some of the additions and amendments which have been made to the bill as approved by the Lok Sabha back to the Lok Sabha very soon, subject to the directions of the Speaker, so that the Lok Sabha also can approve the bill and then it can go to the states for ratification. Once the GST is implemented, it will bring basic changes as far as the Indian tax structure is concerned. It will convert India into one unified market with one unified tax in the country. It will improve the base of taxation. It will make evasion extremely difficult. And I think the center and the state governments in future will have to work together in order to make this a great success. Overall, I think it was an excellent debate in which almost every member has contributed to it. And as I just stated earlier, this is Indian democracy and federalism both at their very best. Thank you.
Let's now go across to our colleague Rituparna Bhuyan. He's got with him the Minister of State for Finance, Arjun Ram Meghwal. Let's just listen into what the Minister of State for Finance, remember we have two of them, but here's Mr. Meghwal in conversation with our colleague Rituparna Bhuyan. We'll get to that in just a second. We do now have Mr. Praful Patel. Let's just listen into what he has to say.
आम सहमति से आज पारित हुआ बहुत अच्छी बात है देश के लिए अच्छी बात है और इससे राज्यों का भी भला होगा और विशेष करके जो राज्यों को पिछड़ापन आज तक महसूस होता था उनको भी अधिक निधि मिलेगी और इससे आगे जो भी कुछ अभी बिल आएगा नवंबर के सेशन में उसमें भी इसी तरह आम सहमति बनेगी ऐसा मुझे विश्वास है
कांग्रेस एंड बीजेपी 10 साल ये बिल डिले किया अब बिल पास हो गया वेरी वेरी गुड बट ये कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल अमेंडमेंट बिल है इसके बाद November mein, we also need to continue like this. Nahi to April 1 mein, April Fool joke ho jayega. To main, we are requesting the BJP and the Congress to get it done in November so we can implement this bill 1st April 2017. First innings abhi khatam hua, abhi second innings hoga November mein. Good.
Just want to say, it is only an end of a beginning. The real work starts now. In fact, there is a lot of hard work now involved. Our department will have to really work on a war footing to see to it that as early as possible we are able to implement it. That's all I want to say for the.
Right, so what's the roadmap ahead, sir? How quickly are you looking to? Will the one
we'll announce the roadmap tomorrow. Okay, tomorrow 12 o'clock we are going to have a media briefing in the new media center. FM will also.
So is 1/17 looking feasible, sir, at this point?
We'll tell you all that tomorrow. Okay, wait till tomorrow.
We'll tell you all on the on tomorrow. That's the Revenue Secretary Rituparna Bhuyan in conversation with the Minister of State for Finance, Mr. Meghwal.
The GST Council will decide it.
Right.
And what it is a mandate of the GST Council.
Right. So what about the impact on inflation? Because that is one issue which many members had raised during the discussion phase, saying that perhaps this could lead to more inflationary pressures.
It is against the mandate of the GST Council. They will decide.
So by when do we see the GST Council being formed, sir?
Yeah, very soon. Right. After the rectification.
Very soon is the word coming in there from the Minister of State for Finance. Let me start getting wrap-up comments from our tax experts who have patiently been sitting in with us over the last several hours now watching this debate. Final comments, let me start by asking you, Sachin.
Well, I think the statement of the Revenue Secretary is very apt. The real test of how a best good GST rollout is now beginning. Lot of areas where there has to be a consensus, and I would imagine that the current draft which is circulated need not be that complicated. We can have a simple GST. And one important thing I want to tell the audience is that so far the consultation with the industry and what is that is good for the industry was taken a backseat. So the consultation should be starting with the industry, each of the industry sectors, and understanding their problem. And the kind of provisions like related party transaction, valuation rules, etc., perhaps it's unwarranted because all this complications which is built into the law is only would help the government to collect the tax maybe 1 month earlier. Because end of the day, the value addition, whatever is being added to the product and the goods and services is anyway going to be get taxed till the last leg. So therefore, many of those complications can be eased out and we can have a best of GST in the prevailing circumstances and which is respected by the people of India as well as the world. So I would rather wish all the best to the industry and the government that there will be a dialogue will take place and we'll have a good GST law.
Yes, certainly. Lots of luck is needed. Rohan, final comments from you.
Absolutely historic day. I think it's a culmination of the effort of many, many people that as a nation we stand at this stage today. So I would say, you know, congratulations to us as a nation and to everyone. At the same time, while we savor this moment, let's not underestimate the amount of work which is still left to be done and the time frames in which we have to do it. And, you know, a lot of the debate has been about the center and the state. I think it's important that the debate now includes industry, because if there is one participant who matters the most, it is the industry and then the consumer. And from my perspective, it's high time that, you know, they also have a polar position at the table now to influence what is going to happen.
Well, Sachin and Rohan Shah, appreciate you joining us. Let me get in final comments from Naushad Forbes, of President of CII. You've just heard both our tax experts there saying that, you know, lots of luck is now needed for industry to sit down with the government to try and thrash out and iron out the fine print as far as the GST bill itself is concerned. Mr. Forbes, what should we now expect in terms of next steps?
I agree fully with the comments. I think the work does in many start now, and I think it's we have actually on the draft law, the government put the draft law up for discussion and comments some months ago, which was a very welcome move. We've submitted from CII many detailed comments on the draft, and we look forward to now taking it forward with the government in working all of the detail out. As many of the people said, I think keeping the end objective in mind of having an easy, transparent, inclusive law, ensuring that it achieves our end objective of a combination of ease of collection, tax buoyancy, non-cascading of taxes, full set-offs on all the and a very transparent and simple tax administration. All of this is going to require lots of work. Now we can get on with it. We really look forward to engaging very deeply and closely with the government and working all of this detail out.
Absolutely, and it is not going to be an easy task. We wish you all the luck, Mr. Forbes. Thanks very much for joining us here on CNBC-TV18. Arun, you've been here with me in the studio pretty much from this morning as we watched the parliamentary debate and discussion. Your thoughts, Arun, on what we should now expect as far as the model law and the changes there?
Shireen, I think it's been over 12 years for me covering tax and business journalism, and specifically tax, and I must say this is a red letter day. This is probably once in a lifetime day for many of us journalists in the finance beat. Absolute landmark legislation, the most significant consequential tax reform since independence. One important thing, Shireen, we've been covering the entry tax case in the Supreme Court for the last 2 weeks, and what's the point that's come out? The 9 judges bench, which sits once in 15-20 years, again and again the Chief Justice T.S. Thakur saying that we are concerned about the powers of the states to levy taxes, to raise revenues. We want the state's powers to remain. That's the concern of the bench. And here today, you have the Finance Minister Arun Jaitley finally bringing all the states on board and starting his speech by saying this is pulling in of sovereignty, not surrendering of sovereignty. For that reason alone, this is a red letter day, Shireen, that this managing 30 states, a great republic, 30 states coming on board, different aspirations, different, political compulsions, and in many ways, different outlook towards several aspects. All of them coming on board. I think this is a big, big day. And if we've been able to get this far, I see no reason why we should not be taking the next steps. They are going to be a little more difficult. There will be tough negotiations. There will be give and take. But I think that if we have come so far, then I think we are going to finally cross the Rubicon next April. Shireen.
Well, let's get across to Krish Iyer of Walmart India. He joins us as well. Mr. Iyer, thanks very much for joining us on CNBC-TV18. What does this mean, sir, for the retail sector? I know that this has been a much-anticipated, much-awaited, reform for the sector.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Passing of the GST bill today is an extremely progressive step and a long-awaited one. It is one of the critical tax reforms for the retail market too, because creation of one single market in India for goods and services will certainly boost our economy. A vibrant retail market will mean a lot to driving consumption, and this certainly will be helpful. Besides, I think implementation of GST will reduce transaction cost of doing business, and on the food side particularly, will reduce food wastage, bring down prices, certainly will bring relief to the consumers too.
What does it mean in terms of cost savings, Mr. Iyer? We still don't have clarity on rates, etc., and there are different rates that are being proposed across different categories. But, can you let us know what it would actually mean in terms of transaction costs coming down for industry, for instance?
See, the overall, if you see, although there's not enough clarity on rates and how it will all work out, and one has to look at the fine print, but overall, if you see purely from a logistics point of view, today in every state one has to create a distribution center because of this multiple.
Sir, I'd request you to just hold on for 1 second. It's the man of the moment, the chief economic advisor, the man who's been talked about in every single parliament.